Hey everybody, how you doing? This is Musa Jackson, your host, and we are here at Ambassador Digital Magazine Live. Wow, I love saying that. And we have an incredible show for you tonight. I am so excited about tonight. It's just going to be, we have the most amazing guest. He is Harlem royalty, I like to say, and we're going to bring him out shortly. But first, you know how we do. We talk about everything that's happening, that's going on in the world, and I have to take a collective sigh, especially being in this skin, being a Black man, because it's, you know, it's deep. You know, here we are. I'm losing track of days, but we're somewhat at 170 days, and it's a great day to arrest the killers of Breonna Taylor. Okay, so we're going to start there. We are still in the midst of a pandemic, so we still send our love out to the our frontline essential healthcare workers. They're still working in other parts of the country, even in New York. So we just always give them love for doing the good fight for all of us and taking care of us. And wow, all I can say is, you know, we're doing this every week and we love the support. It's amazing. And I gotta tell you guys, every week, I gotta report, it's almost weekly, I gotta report what's happened, what's someone else, Jacob, Blake. This one, another one that just hit me in the heart when I heard this story that has once again riveted and shocked our nation, shocked every person, everybody that I know, especially every Black man, every Black family specifically that I know to the core. Jacob Blake was out with his children in Wisconsin, and he was headed towards his car. He was tailed by cops. And as he was getting into his vehicle where his children were, he was shot 7 times in the back. He is paralyzed at this moment. And of course, the cop that shot him, the officers that are also responsible because they were there, but the cop that shot him has not been arrested or charged. And protests have broken out in his city, and of course around the country, and it's just it's a travesty, you know, that we have to wake up every day to this. Every day it seems like we're waking up to something like this, and a protest happened. And a protest was happening the other day, and a 17-year-old white supremacist armed with an AKA rifle went into the march, shot and killed 2 people and wounded another, and actually was able to, with his hands up, with the rifle, walk past the police. And I believe one offered him water. I kind of have to let that one sink in for a minute, just the thought of that, the stark contrast, why they were there, because an innocent man was with his children on, I think, on one of his son's birthday. And this person went across state lines with his mother, by the way, brought him there, and killed 2 people. And then managed to make his way into another state where he was finally arrested. He has been apprehended. This is shockwaves everywhere. Also, yesterday, the NBA, WNBA, Major League Baseball, Major League Soccer boycotted this. As well as Naomi Osaka, the tennis player, and Kenny Smith walked off his live TV show. I think the only way that we're going to find any kind of justice is we got to just keep the heat. We got to continue to protest. We've got to continue to make sure that every officer is held accountable. I'm about defunding and reallocating some of those funds to our social services. That's what I'm about. And defunding the police unions, because this is not for us. We are not getting the justice that we deserve. But yet we're still out there. I commend all the protesters around the world that are there on our behalf. Black Lives Matter today, yesterday, every day. I'm sending my prayers once again to the Jacob Blake family, Breonna Taylor, George Floyd. The list is endless. It's absolutely endless. I'm going to get into that later with our esteemed guest. I know he has something to say about this. Here we are with the NBA with there's LeBron. And I'm just going to say, those are heroes right there. Those are heroes. You know, that's what you do. That's how you protest. You know, we have to hit them in the pocket. We have to continue this, relentless pursuit for justice. And it's interesting how the 60s we're more like the 60s, you know, reminds you of the Olympics, you know, very similar. And also tomorrow is not only the anniversary of the March on Washington, which happened in August 28th, 1963. There will be a march once again tomorrow, because we have obviously not seemed to learn how to live together, and they have not seemed to learn how to honor Black people who helped build this country. So here we are. My father marched, was one of those people in that crowd. Ironically, we lost John Lewis, who was the youngest speaker at that march. Many young people were at that march, just like there'll be many young people at this march. They seem to be the ones that are that are moving us towards justice. I have a lot of faith in our young people, and all who are going to the march, I wish you safety. I wish it's going to be a huge turnout. So carry your water. I've been to a march. I was at the Million Mile March, the first one, and then the one that happened 20 years later. I went to both, and it's so carry your water. Make sure you have that, your vitamins, all those things, some food, because it's going to be packed, and getting different places, that's going to be hard. Okay. So, and I wish everyone love that will be traveling, and travel safely. Paul, you're going to be traveling, so you can talk about that maybe later. You're going to be traveling too, Paul, to the march. So anyway, now our main, we have very little bit of time, but I wanted to bring all our topics. We have an amazing guest. What can I say about this man? He is the ultimate Renaissance man. He is a master chef, world-class chef. He owns restaurants around the world. One right here in Harlem, Red Rooster, the most brilliant restaurant we have. He is an author. I have his books right here. He is a philanthropist. He is a star. He is a father. He's a husband. He is our esteemed guest, the magnificent, my good friend, Chef Marcus Samuelsson.
Thank you, Musa. How are you?
I'm good. Good to see you.
Well, first of all, congrats to you, and you're adding so much joy in the community. And this is a time where we have to look out for one another and talk to one another. As you know, COVID will stay in our community longer than most urban communities. Will stay in places like Harlem, Newark, Overtown, Detroit. And bringing community together, it's really, really important, specifically because we have also the thing that's been in our country the longest, racism, right? So we really, as Black people, we navigate through many voices, through many spaces. So this is great. Congratulations to your vision.
Thank you so much, Marcus. I mean, I knew you'd jump right in. And talk, but you know, we're going to take it back a bit because we have a limited amount of time. Thank you so much for coming on our show, and take us back to maybe your early beginning. What was young Marcus like? People would like
I always give gratitude to my grandparents. You know, my grandparents grew up very poor in Sweden, and so poverty was something we talked about. You know, I was very fortunate. I grew up in middle class, upper middle class neighborhood. But poverty was at the table. It was not something that was esoteric. They grew up during the Second World War. And that's what I think Zion will remember from this time, is this moment is a life-defining moment, right? And he might get tired of hearing about COVID when he's 15, 16, and he wants to move on. But as parents, we can't move on, because this is something that is with us in a very deep tissue way, the way the world, Second World War was for them. Also, my parents, you know, we were very loved, me and my two sisters, and white parents raising three Black kids in a majority, predominantly white country. There was challenges there, but there was never a challenge on love, you know what I mean? I always felt loved.
Did your parents also give you a sense of, okay, because they're Swedish and you're Ethiopian, did you also have that cultural side with it? Did they enforce the Ethiopian side of you, or was that something that you found later on?
You know, that's a good question, Musa. I think adoption lands very different on different people.
Okay.
But adopted people always have a connection, right? Like, I was just talking to Daryl over at Run DMC. And Daryl's is adopted, and I'm adopted, so we always have that friendship. Or people can come up to me at an airport, at the restaurant, and say, "I'm also adopted." And
right. Wow.
So it's that dual identity of being adopted, but then also the identity of being Black, and then also being a kid, right? Mm-hmm. So Ethiopian culture came later. My mom tried to give it to us early, but then we just wanted to be Swedish kid and fit in. Mm-hmm. So I think it came in my late teens, early 20s, that I really want to go explore my Ethiopian side.
Okay. And was that, and at that time, did you have a passion for food, or were you always someone who wanted to be a chef, or was
yeah.
there? Okay. Wow.
I mean, I still to this day, cooking, just like the fashion space for you through modeling and from being in the space, is taking you to places that maybe you wouldn't have been, right?
Right.
And for both Maya and me, modeling for Maya, has right. taken us over the world, from Paris right. to LA to Milano, and navigated. And cooking has been that vehicle for me. You know, I went to Japan as a teenager to cook. I went to Switzerland and France. You have to navigate just as a young cook. We also have to navigate in foreign countries as a young Black man.
Yeah.
And the majority of people you work with have never met a Black person.
Yeah, absolutely.
So you just like your magazine is about being an ambassador, mm-hmm. you know, you're also an ambassador of the culture mm-hmm. in a space where people just don't even know how to relate.
Absolutely. But interesting that you say that, because being a young person, which you were, you with a huge responsibility, Marcus. I mean, it's unfathomable. I mean, when I think about it, that you were only in your early 20s when you became executive chef of
yeah.
major restaurants. I mean, my God, where does that drive? Or I mean, where does that come from?
Well, you know, Musa, you know, the blessings of being a Black man is that you have, the choices is not linear, right? So sometimes you can see a young Black actress and how can she do it? How can he do it? Or
right.
sometimes you see a gymnast that is like so much better, because
right.
we have to be number one kids, right? There is no, and it was very easy for me. No, I shouldn't say easy, but it was like, if I would get the scholarship, I had to be number one.
Got it. Right.
And that gives you a certain level of focus. And if you're healthy and get the support that I had from mentors, you can do it.
You can do
and
it.
And I was told I could do it.
And you had mentors. You had
amazing.
Okay.
And they were majority people that saw something in me. They also knew that once I was out there, it would be rougher for me. They knew more about that than I knew. So I was, in hindsight, I realized, oh, that's what he was talking about.
Got it.
That's what she was saying about that.
Got it.
You know, when you're 18, 19, 20, 21, you just got to navigate. And right. It's tough.
Right. Absolutely. So here's another, how did you and I've never asked you this question. And we've actually, this is our third interview. I work for different magazines, but this is my magazine.
Yes.
How about that? How did you meet your wife? Your beautiful
Harlem brings all of us together. My former apartment over on 118th Street, I actually had a housewarming. My friend was there, and we had a big party for him in my apartment. And so many people came, so I actually had to leave because I was like, too many people in this apartment. I got to go. Uh-huh. I got to work the next day. They could all party. And as I was leaving, Maya came up in the elevator. And so I stayed. And then
of course she did.
At my own party. But then I had to leave anyway because the next day I had to go to Europe and cook or whatever. So we didn't meet until like a couple of weeks later again. And then we just met up. And yeah, we've been together ever since.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
I love that. I love it because I love her. I love you guys.
Thank you.
Let's see a picture of his love.
Yeah.
So yeah. Awesome. Beautiful Maya, supermodel.
Yeah, it was fun. You know, the shoot was so much fun.
Your
team was amazing. And it's very rarely that we really bring designs to shoot because it's very personal. But we know you and we know that, you know, it's family. And it was, you know, Brad was so gracious with his. You know, to allow us to be there. So we like, sure, absolutely, let's do it.
Lovely. And so interestingly enough, I was going to, being a super couple, you know, her being busy, you know what I mean? And you being busy, the two of you together, how do you guys manage to make it all work for those parents out there that have busy lives and they want to kind of, I mean, I see you guys together, but how do you guys make it work? As a couple,
I think you have to work on it and respect that, you know, you want to add to each other's life. Like Maya was modeling way before she met me. And mm-hmm. I don't ever want her to stop if that's her passion to work within her field, and she should. I've never stopped. So it's always about what you got next week? What do you got? You know, and there are very rough weeks, right? Very, very difficult weeks. But it's also a joy when we get that schedule to work. There's a joy when we sit and have a glass of wine together or we get away on a date night or just being, you know, we had so much joy shooting with you guys because we realized we haven't shot together in a while. And it was high end and it was fun. And you know, it gets you going. This is a memory for us, right? It's not a job for me. It's a memory for us,
100%.
You know? And so we took pleasure in being there together with you. And obviously we're excited about your success. You know, it's about sharing. What I love about Harlem, it's a village, right? So we're all in each other's businesses, which is beautiful. You know, like if I don't see Rakim and Gloria for a week or I don't hear from them, I'm like, what's going on? If I don't hear from Melba or Melba doesn't, you know what I mean? Like, and that's something very beautiful. And to have a village and a neighborhood within this big city, in this moment, it's so important because we all are grieving right now.
Yeah.
We all are walking, and it's amazing that Michelle Obama took the first step and publicly said, that she was dealing with a little bit of depression. It's okay to talk about that because we should.
Yeah. Yes.
It's hard out there.
Absolutely. And I'm interested that you said that. I mentioned it also on my show. I was dealing with depression.
Yes.
And part of getting through my depression, honestly, was launching Ambassador Digital Magazine.
Yeah.
I had to stay connected.
Yeah.
As you said, I come from a village. And to be someone who's extremely well-known and connected and bring people together and somewhat being off to the side and being trapped, I needed to connect. So I completely understand. Speaking of the Obamas, nice segue.
Yes.
What was it like to meet? Okay, so here you are with my girlfriend.
Yeah.
Okay.
Now, right?
Former president, but I just got to let you guys know, she's forever my girlfriend. Yeah. Michelle Obama. What is it like? What is that couple like? Can we, I mean, in this age with, you know, ugh, what's out there, this breath of fresh air. Can you talk a little about the Obamas? Because you guys did the first dinner as well as had them at your restaurant.
Yeah, I mean, I would say they're equally amazing on very different things, right? When you're in a room with Michelle, before she was the first lady, there's a gravitas around Michelle Obama that she just has, that she's born with. She's super bright, super engaging, a force, and you're just impressed. That's the person in the room that everybody would be drawn to, right? She just has that. She has it, you know, and backs it up with being humble when she needs to be humble, and you know, pushing when she needs to be pushing, and just like amazing, you know. You don't need me to tell you that, but she's amazing.
Yeah,
and you know, the president, what he means as a symbol to Black people around the world, there's no words that sums that up. But he was the chosen one in that space, right? The humility about his journey, and then the excellence knowing that to deliver when he was on that big stage. And we miss him so much talk about a time when we truly missed him in terms of we need to navigate through a space. Imagine if he would have 3 more years to build on healthcare. That number would not have been 175,000 American deaths, majority Black and brown people. That would have looked different, right? So this is not a joke, this is serious. Mm-hmm. And election has consequences, and it's a very, very sad time right now.
Yeah, and interesting that you mentioned that we all are in this together. Okay, you know, like you said, having Red Rooster, having restaurants around the world, but living in Harlem, how did you pivot, man, with Red Rooster? How did you deal begin with this pandemic, if I might ask?
Well, you know, we're still in it. You know, I would say, on a couple of levels, on a personal level, you know, waking up every day and acknowledge your privilege. Zion is healthy. My wife is healthy. I'm healthy. You have to acknowledge your privilege, right?
Right.
On second, I can always find work that I can provide for my family. That's privilege. You have to acknowledge that in these times. So that's on a personal side. On a professional side, I won't be healed until Rooster is back up full, until Jinnis has his band, until Gloria and Rakim are fully there on a Monday, and we're all together, and that's gonna take, so I'm hurting inside. Like, I did this for all of us, and it's like, I'm happy when downstairs is jumping and kitchen is busy upstairs, and the room, young and old, is in the house. And sure, it's great to be open on the patio, and I really appreciate everyone coming together to do that, but I miss that open, what makes Rooster Rooster, which is a busy upstairs and a busy downstairs, and people just being together. And obviously we have to do it in the safest way, so we cannot do that. Right. But I don't think I will be fully healed until that is back, right? So for me, it's about how can you evolve and work on Black excellence without the normal canvas? What would an artist do? So I started this moment, my podcast, right?
Right.
Me and my buddy Jason happen to be African American living in Sweden, and I'm being Swedish living here. What do these two Black creatives do? So we talk about it, and it's, you know, we have people like amazing people on it, and it's just been part doing a podcast, but also part healing.
Mm.
The second part I focused on is Black excellence. The book, The Rise, my cookbook that is coming out this fall, focused on 40 of the most influential African-American chefs and writers, food writers in this country, and why Black food history is America's history.
Mm-hmm.
And we have to take the authorship about our food back and put it back into the history books. Because if you look at American food now, we're not in it yet. Right. We work the land, we cook the food, and we created a huge part of American food scene.
It's so important. I agree with you 100%. It's so important that we tell our stories.
Yeah.
We claim it.
Claim it.
And that we teach it.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And also, you know, in case people don't know about your podcast, it's the name of it, This Moment Podcast,
yeah.
Right? Which,
yeah.
as you mentioned, for your buddy Jason from
Timbuktu,
who's in Sweden, and you're here, and you guys are talking about, you know, all the social issues, and I love things like that. I love that. Another part of you that people don't know, because they know the chef, which we all love. They know, you know, some people know you from Top Chef. The reality star on TV, but you're also very socially conscious and very much into your community. You came, never forget when you came, man. Being here when Marcus arrived in Harlem, it was an epic moment because you brought so much love and passion and a sense of, you said, I'm here, this is my home too. And so, you mentioned about you being privileged.
Mm.
We both, yes, I can find work. I know I can. Having that sense of privilege, right? Somewhere as well as yourself, right? But being an immigrant and knowing that a lot of your workers or whoever, or other workers, other restaurants around the city in Harlem per se, you know what I mean? Talk about that. What is that like, and how have you been able to maybe make an inroad or impact that?
Yeah.
Even the neighborhood.
Yeah, I would say, you know, speaking on the immigrant side, I think there for me is linked to being Black. First of all, I wouldn't be here without the work that your grandparents and parents did, right? The civil rights movement opened doors for people like me, right? Mm-hmm. African Americans inspire and aspire the world and giving culture to the world to so many. And I'm a product of that. Mm-hmm. So the tables were set. It wasn't perfect, but it was set for someone like me to come here and add value. And that's all we want to do as an immigrant. We just want to get in, work hard, and add value.
Right.
And so I want to humanize that experience. I am that immigrant. I'm also a Black man, so navigating both of those. Harlem then, even the top of that being adopted, a place like Harlem, you're searching for a home. And I think through my adopted African roots, through my Blackness, and through being an immigrant, Harlem becomes the perfect place for me.
Absolutely.
Not for everyone, but if it's someone like me, someone like you. And there's different reasons.
Mm-hmm.
We coexist, and we are neighbors and we work together collectively, right? So, you know, during this pandemic, Red Rooster pivoted. I would say we've done some of the most important work ever during this pandemic.
Mm.
When we pivoted in late March from being a traditional restaurant to being a community center, we didn't know at that time, how do you serve social distance?
Right.
There was no guidelines. Where did the mask going to come from? Where is the glove going to come from? But to work with World Center Kitchen,
right.
I couldn't have been prouder of our teams coming in every day, showing up, serving about 1,000 people a day.
Right.
It's still going. So we've served over 250,000 meals in the community collectively with World Center Kitchen. And not only our restaurant, you know, we had to pivot our Harlem Eat Up Festival to Harlem Serves Up, which involved, 15 other Harlem restaurants.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what we do as a community, but that's what we do as restaurateurs. And you see incredible entrepreneurs like Lolo Seafood Shack, you know, Carlos over at Boulevard, Melba's, you name it. Everybody came together and said, how do we do this, Vinateria? And A, it gave food to the neediest and the first responders. B, it created jobs back so people can go back slowly back to work in a safe way.
Right.
And it also helped the food infrastructure that was completely broken, right?
Right.
Because Musa, we're part of a larger society. I'm just going to give you some boring numbers, but there's 11 million restaurant workers in this country. 16 million when you think about all the ancillary workers around it. 70% of them are unemployed right now. And that impacts completely black and brown people completely different, because we are the people that work in restaurants.
Absolutely. Right.
So this matters. This is not about me as a person. This is about us as a community. And how can I, as a chef with the platform, provide and do my part?
Interesting that you said. I got a question for you. Actually, our dear friend, Reggie Van Lee.
Yes.
Had a great question. He, what do you think is the future of the restaurant business post-COVID? This is a great question. And for Harlem in particular.
Well, Reggie, if anyone would know, because I don't know much. Reggie's like at the top of the, like the, one of the brightest, smartest thinkers out there. And he's also, what I love about Reggie is always figure out the bridge between culture, heavily involved in African-American culture, but also, of course, on the business aspect. So he's like an uncle that I always go and ask for advice. But thank you for that question, Reggie. Okay, I want to say it in two parts. Right now, to answer that question truly, it's too early, because we're in it. Right. And it's never really good when you're being completely attacked. We're still in it.
Yeah.
I can't look outside. I don't see the light at the end of the tunnel yet. Mm-hmm. I do think the model that we created actually in Newark, where you meet when you have the private sector and the public sector coming together, right? In Newark, we do it with World Central Kitchen and Newark Worker Kitchen, where Audible, Don Katz, raised the first money collectively with us and Michael B. Jordan. So you have the restaurant world, you have the private sector, and then you have someone like Michael B. Jordan that can broadcast throughout the world, right?
Mm-hmm.
Then the local government came in and supported that as well. That saved Newark's restaurant industry.
Wow.
So I think if we're going to navigate out this, we need help from the private sector. Mm-hmm. You know, local government to acknowledge that we can't just let, it's not okay to say 80% of our workers are going to be unemployed. Right. So we need help and support to navigate out this very, very difficult situation, because we are a very particular business, and it's not a high margin business, right? So we are very fragile as a community.
Yeah, yeah. And that's why I asked, because you're right. When the city as a whole gets a cold, we get pneumonia.
Yeah.
So I know what you're doing, and as you mentioned, all the other restaurants coming together collectively, here's the time, ironically, where we're supposed to be somewhat separated, right? Here's actually the time where we have to figure out how to come together, and you are doing that. You know, I'm gonna pivot just a little bit, just because, you know, both of us being black men, being fathers, you know, I have to touch on this. I touched on this earlier in the show. I wanna know your thoughts on, because you know, on Jacob Blake, what just happened, which of course is a, Marcus, is a series, but just the gravitas of that in terms of how it's also what just recently happened with the 17-year-old killer and then the NBA. So it's just all this swirl, if you know what I mean. I want to know which your thoughts on that. Marcus,
it's so saddening. It makes me so furious. But I can't walk around angry every day. But that's how I feel. Right? Not yet again. The names are changing, but the narratives and the stories are not changing. Right? But they're yet different. You know. If you close your eyes and imagine Breonna Taylor, where can you be? Where should you be the safest? It's in your bed, in your own house. Like that, it's an impossible even nothing. Think about, here is Jacob Blake, being in the community, breaking up an argument, being a community person, and then you know also that the deconstruction of us can happen, because it's happening right now with George Floyd. That all these conversation about what drugs he was on, and it wasn't the offices and major media platforms allow that conversation to happen, which is disgusting, right? It happens, and then the deflect comes. But each story is different. You know, the Jacob Blake, for me, it's Tamir Rice, Jacob Blake, and the 17-year-old that walked down the street with a weapon. Here you have, I know I don't want to go back to Tamir, but it's like, here you have a 12-year-old with a plastic handgun, which is in the summertime where kids are playing with all the time. And here you have somebody walking down with a rifle and just gets a chance to drive to a different state, right? And here you have Jacob Blake being shot 7 times in the back. So when we talk about, and in the middle of that convention that is happening at the same time, right? And it's so there's so many conversations, and but I'm also equally proud of the athletes and people speaking up, and LeBron is really leading this. And this is a very unique time, and it's so much coming at you. It's hard to digest, but I thought Jacob Blake's sister really said it the best. You know, when you listen to her composure when she spoke, just go back and listen to her, because it's so sad. It's just very, and the world is watching, right? So COVID, we couldn't wrap ourselves around, right? And at the same time, of course, the war on racism, which has been our ugly history for hundreds and hundreds of years. We need to deal with them both.
Hold on.
Because they're horrible.
He's having little technical difficulties.
Yeah.
Might have to come in and out, guys.
All right. You good, Musa?
Marcus. Hold on.
No, I got you. I see you. Well, anyway, I want to applaud you, Musa, for doing the show and for having the magazine.
Here we have to reboot.
Hey, how's everybody doing? Right now you're live at Guinness. And I'm going to go upstairs at Red Rooster now. And I'm just waiting for Musa to come back in. That's great. Thank you for giving me the update. That's nice. We can hear you both. Okay, so they can hear us. Thank you, Crystal. Is Musa coming back in? Well, anyway, I'm going to give you a little tour. You know, I'm going to go upstairs and see if you guys can follow me. All right. That shoot was really magical because Musa had his whole team on it, which was great. So I'm going to go back up in the restaurant. All right, so we're live at Rooster. All right, now we're in the restaurant. And
I'm in.
Oh. Yeah.
Hey.
Yeah, I took them on the floor.
I almost lost you. You lost me.
Yeah.
Okay. Was that me or you? I don't know. It doesn't matter. Listen. So we have a few minutes left.
Yeah.
With you. And I definitely want to see that cover.
Yes.
Okay. So, Paul, can we show that cover?
I want to make sure Marcus's like connection's up. He was freezing for a second. All right, hang on a second. Let me slide over and I'll get to the images. Hold on.
Okay. And then we can talk a little bit more, but let's just get the cover out for the viewers. They love to see this cover. And I love everything that you're saying. I hope everyone was able to gather all this information. As we know, this is what happens with, you know, connections.
Yes, I have the, I'm actually doing a shoot at the restaurant today. So that's why it's been up, been so much up and down. Oh, nice. Amazing.
Thank you.
Beautiful.
You know what's interesting is, okay, so there's Marcus, his beautiful wife, and I wanted to name it One Love. And here's the irony.
Nice.
Irony is you know, I don't always read the captions or the hashtags that people put underneath their photos, but if you go to your wife's fetch, half of them have One Love. So I was like, that's synchronicity, but it's so true. The two of you together was a pleasure to work with our incredible team. Paul, you did a great job shooting the cover. Paul.
It was a good day.
Yeah, Lou, of course, Lewis, everybody.
Great team. Kevin McQueen, makeup, hair done by Stephen Rice. We had Josh Wells doing video, as well as Courtney doing BTS behind the scenes. Thank you to Anthony Maxwell, those beautiful hats. You'll see it later on in the issue. Harlem Haberdashery, 5001 Flavors, as well as Edwin D'Angelo. Such a, it takes a team of courage to make it happen. And your beautiful son, he did really well, by the way. At 4 years old,
he had fun.
Another thing is, I want to just throw this in there. Zion and my daughter, Jade, were born on the same day. So we share that too.
Oh, yes.
Yes.
Okay.
That's right.
What, about 10 years apart, right? About 10 years apart?
You know, but definitely very similar personalities. Definitely.
Yeah.
They are take charge.
Musa, this is beautiful. This is beautiful. Thank you for having us. We appreciate it. I got to run up to the shoot. Thank you for everything and congratulations. Paul, thank everybody, you. Great job.
Right. Thank you so much, Mark.
Thank you.
Have a great one. Thank you, guys. Hello, everybody. That was Marcus. You want to show some more? He had to run. We wanted Marcus had a very limited time. He's a very busy man. But look at these beautiful shots. Who's ever still on? We're still live. Isn't that gorgeous, guys? I'm in love. I'm living for that. Living. Great job, crew. I love you guys, as you all know. What a great show. Packed a lot in there, spoke a lot about the businesses of Harlem and just in general, what we've got to do is stick together during this pandemic and keep our heads and our wits about ourselves. You know, it's a depressing thing sometimes. Marcus hit the nail on the head. Michelle Obama hit the nail on the head. You can be depressed. Look at this gorgeous shot. Look, oh, that's Ethiopian, Swedish, Harlem royalty right there. Lewis, you killed it, baby. You did your thing. Paul, you did it. I love it. Thank you, guys. Paul's going to show some more shots, but I just want to still always talk to our viewers. Support us. Tell people about us. It's at @ambassador_mag. I want to say thank you to all of our followers. In less than in 2 months, we have almost 700 followers already with very little advertisement, but the word has caught on. Obviously, Marcus loves the magazine. Many more coming. I've been getting calls, honestly, from, I'll be quite frank, around the world already, from Africa, even Hong Kong, everywhere. So, but we're going to keep it Harlem and always bring us to them. They're going to come to us. And connection in that way. I love spotlighting my community, amazing families, people that are doing the work, that are putting it in. We've highlighted so many great people already. This is issue number 15. I can't even believe I'm saying that. It's growing by leaps and bounds. Maybe Paul, you wanna show them our commercial? Oh, look at this. Look at that shot. Paul, when I saw that, it just broke my heart in terms of a good way. It melted my heart, as I would say that. It melted my heart when I saw that, because every mother, every father, you know, that embellishes just what it's like to be in love with your child. And the look on Maya's face with Zion is just epic. When she sees it, Maya, I wish you were here, darling, but we will be sending you these photos and you'll be seeing these photos when you go to Ambassador Digital Magazine on Facebook as well as YouTube. Please follow us. Please subscribe. Please, you can also donate. There's a hashtag. We have Cash App? Hashtag Harlem Ambassador. Help us get to the next level. I love this shot. Paul, it's a beautiful shot. Wanted to do, the whole idea was one love, the family. That was the story behind this. And wanted to celebrate. That's Marcus Garvey Park, Mount Morris Park for us old timers. And Maya's in a traditional Ethiopian dress. Her hat is Anthony Maxwell. And her face is beat by Kevin McQueen. Hair in a chignon by Stephen Rice. Shot by our creative director, photographer Paul. Morejon. I said it right that time. And I just want to say, I did right? I did good? Can't hear you, buddy. Okay, but you know, and we do have a couple, you know, a few more minutes, but I just want to say to everyone that's still looking, you know, we have any more shots? Oh, also, maybe you could show them the commercial, our video. Did a beautiful video. Josh Wells did an incredible video. Oh, Marcus just sent a beautiful note. He just sent, oh, Maya. Zion, I love you, bro. Congrats. Mama's putting baby boy to sleep. We love you guys. Peace and Black Lives Matter. That was from Maya. She just sent me a text. That's another thing about this. This is social media. Most of, you know, that's how we connect nowadays. That's how we're bringing you this great content. Maybe we could show them the video, Paul. Our Live Your Life with Passion. If you have that. But listen, one of the things I was reiterating is people might be leaving if they're not already in DC. We have people in DC. And we just want to make sure that you're safe. Oh, here we go. Here's our. Okay, we're back. Live Your Life with Passion. Josh Wells did an incredible job. I also want to send a shout out to Chef Lexis Creations for those custom masks. Thank you, everyone, for the love. Once again, we are Ambassador Digital Magazine. It is exploding. We have many more coming. We are here every. We are live every week. If we take a week off, we'll let you know. But we come every week, current topics, as well as great covers and celebrating the best of the best from fashion, food, entertainment, art, theater, film, TV, politics, culture. We do it all. So here we are. I want to thank you all for showing up. I want to thank you all for being incredible supporters. I want to shout out. I'm going to go ahead and just shout out a few people that I see. Diane. Shell, Crystal, Noyata, Courtney, I see you. Josh, I see you. Right? A few other people came on and they left because I'm still here talking. You're just talking, huh? but no, thank you. And Paul, you got anything to say? Paul, your mic's off. Your mic's off, buddy. Your mic. Where's your mic?
How about that?
We can hear
all right,
you now.
So I think we're off for next week because of Labor Day, right?
Is it Labor Day next week?
I think so. Is it? Or maybe not.
In the week after.
Okay, so who's next week? What's happening?
Next week, we got Flo and Gala.
Awesome.
Flo
She's amazing.
She's amazing. She's Harlem and she's African. And she is an incredible photographer. She's 25 years old. She's gorgeous. She's like the it girl. She is a major photographer. Has shot for Rolling Stones, Billboard magazine, and she shot WAP with Cardi B, Megan Thee Stallion, and what's that girl's name? She's from a family. They all up in the internet. Starts with a J. Other families with a K. I can't remember the name, but I think it might be a Anyway, the Jenner, Kylie Jenner. And we'll talk about that. We'll get into that. And it's going to be hosted. We have a surprise host. So I have a co-host coming, which we have not done yet. So I will let you know who that co-host is. We'll let you know. Okay. But I want to thank everybody for coming on. Thank you, Marcus Samuelsson. Thank you, Maya. Thank you, Zion. Thank you to our incredible team for a wonderful show again. And thank you to the Village of Harlem. Without you, I'm nothing. And with you, I'm everything. How about that? And we're gonna end with this beautiful family, a picture of love, one love. That's what we are, guys. We are one love. And I wish all of you love. Go be safe if you're traveling. Be safe. Drink, have your water. Look out for one another. Do not travel alone. Do not travel alone. You see something, you say something. You see somebody suspicious, you report it to others. I don't know. Unfortunately, I can't always say the authorities, because authorities seem like they're not even on our side. But make sure you, whatever you do, guys, you're in teams, okay? You see somebody suspicious out there, because I'm just saying this because I'm just being careful. I love my people way too much, okay? So y'all be careful out there, and with Godspeed, God's loving arms wrapped around y'all. It will be an amazing march. And you, Paul, you travel safely, my brother.
Thank you very much. I am leaving tomorrow, and I'm very excited. So, yeah, I will be extra safe.
You're going for a day, right? You're only going for one day?
I'm going to come back maybe Saturday. We'll see. But I definitely think at least a day, maybe one more day. We'll see. Okay. Yeah, I'm meeting up with one of the Harlem churches down there. So I'm excited to kind of be marching.
Right.
So it'll be exciting.
Wonderful. You're going. You have me there in spirit. You have my family there in spirit.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, my dad is going to be watching over you. He was at the original march in 1963. So he's no longer with us, but I know he's with you guys in spirit.
Okay? I'm feeling good about it, so I'm excited. All right.
Good about it. Mad pictures. All
right, thank you.
All right. Thank you guys for joining us. So we love you. Mwah, mwah.
Bye.
Ciao.
Ciao.